Hello, everybody. I hope you're all well. I am finally back in my reality TV analysis era. I'm getting emotional. And the reality TV show I'm going to be analysing, or I don't even think that this could pass as an analysis, this is more of a very sort of light-hearted review. The niche 2010s reality show which I'm going to be reviewing today is The Glee Project, which is obviously a spin-off to the smash hit musical comedy drama Glee. And the sole purpose of The Glee Project was to find fresh new faces for Glee, because as we know, the original cast were due to graduate from William McKinley High that year, so they wanted to find a new pool of talent, basically. So the prize of The Glee Project was a 7-episode arc on Glee. Sorry, am I the only one that thinks that that is literally the best prize ever? The stakes are extremely high, and it aired for 2 seasons between 2011 and 2012, and it was produced by Ryan Murphy, who was the creator of Glee, and Dante De Laurentiis, who is a producer on Glee. And the two main judges on the first season are Glee's casting director Robert J. Ulrich and Glee choreographer Zach Woodley. And in the second season, it was those two plus Glee vocalist Nikki Anders. But just before we get into it, I would like to thank the sponsor of today's video, Honey. Honey is an easily downloadable Chrome extension which helps you save money whilst online shopping. How it works is, whilst you're online shopping, you know, you're adding your bits and your pieces to your basket. Instead of having to scour the internet for promo codes, and most of them are usually expired, Honey searches for promo codes so you don't have to. It's the number one shopping tool in America for a reason, and it's because it's so easy to use.
So how it works is, when you're doing your online shopping, you're adding your bits and your pieces to your basket. When you go to check out, the little Honey dancing coin will pop up in the corner and ask if it wants to apply the discounts it's found for you. And that's it. Literally, with just the click of a button, guys, you can save money and you don't have to scour the internet for promo codes.
And using Honey doesn't stop at makeup. It can be used for a wide range of products and websites. Think video games, clothing, shoes, food, on websites which you have probably already used or are already very familiar with. Sorry, but there is nothing more satisfying than saving money with minimal effort. And the best part about Honey is that it's free. So make sure you click my link in the description, which is joinhoney.com/JordanTeresa. That is joinhoney.com/JordanTeresa, to add Honey to your browser for free and save money whilst online shopping. Thank you again, Honey, for sponsoring today's video. Just before we talk about the Glee Project and what a typical episode looks like, I feel like it's very important to give everyone context on how much a cultural phenomenon Glee was, because I know a lot of you guys are quite young and you may not have remembered when Glee first aired and how much of a huge deal it was. Glee first premiered in 2009. I was around 10 or 11 years old, and I remember it pretty clearly, and I'm not exaggerating when I say this. It was huge. And if you guys have never watched Glee before, it is a comedy slash drama slash musical. And Glee's popularity was almost instant. The pilot averaged 9.62 million viewers, and the finale episode of season one raked in 11.07 million viewers, and all of the episodes in between the pilot and the finale of season one pulled between 6 to 13 million viewers. And their highest viewed episode is season two, episode 11, the Sue Sylvester Shuffle, which was watched by a whopping 26.8 million viewers. And Glee Glee's instant success catapulted their entire cast into stardom. Magazine covers, TV interviews, they went on tour and sold out massive arenas all around the world. There was a very active Glee fandom on Twitter and especially on Tumblr. You just had to be there. Like, the whole world had Glee fever. The whole world had Gleever. And despite the fear-mongering that Glee was rotting children's brains, it was enjoyed by both teenagers teenagers and adults alike who tuned in every week to see what Rachel, Finn, Kurt and Mercedes were all up to. And not only was Glee extremely successful, any sort of side project related to Glee, such as the tour, was also extremely successful. So it was almost a given that any project attached to Glee was going to be a hit. So Ryan Murphy and Dante De Laurento created the Glee Project, a reality TV spin-off to find Glee's next big star. And the Glee Project was pretty successful. I couldn't find any exact ratings online, but it was successful enough to launch some of the contestants' careers. And also it was successful enough to have a second season. And apparently the only reason why the Glee Project didn't have a third season was because Glee, the actual TV show, got cancelled. And I do actually remember when the Glee Project was on, and I remember I actually couldn't watch it because when I was younger, I used to have like jealousy problems, like when I was a child. I've grown out of it now, but I used to feel the emotion of jealousy like really, really intensely. And even though I couldn't sing for shit, I really, really wanted to be on the Glee Project. So I couldn't watch it without being filled with jealous rage. Let's finally talk about the Glee Project and what a typical episode looks like. Every episode starts out with Robert J. Ulrich, who I mentioned earlier is Glee's casting director, and a homework assignment is when all of the contestants have to sing a song. But it's not as simple as that. They all have to assign each other roles for the song, which means that people are usually fighting it out for what part of the song they want to sing. They also have to choreograph it as well. And just before Robert sets the homework assignment, he also reveals the theme for the week. Every single episode has a different theme, which usually ends in ality or illity. So for example, individuality, vulnerability, sexuality, danceability, romanticality, pairability, theatricality. I'm not 100% sure that these are all real words, but also I don't care enough to check. And the finale episode was always called Gleeality, and I know that's not a word. And the song set for the homework assignment is always related to the theme, and then they have to perform the song in front of Robert and a special celebrity guest judge who's usually okay. And the guest judge reveal would always make me and Lem laugh because, first of all, I mean, we're kind of in our Glee stan era at the moment. Sorry, that was the most insufferable sentence I've ever said. But these guest appearances can really swing one way or the other, because in some episodes there's like Darren Criss, Amber Riley, and then there's Karofsky, and then there's Coach Beast, and then there's Darren Criss again. But season two really got me because for their guest judges, they got the biggest names in Glee. They got Lea Michele, Corey Monteith, Darren Criss, Naya Rivera, Amber Riley, Chris Colfer, Diana Agron. And then between all of them is the previous winner from the Glee Project and then the mean gay from the Warblers. I'm kidding. The guy that plays the mean gay from the Warblers. Grant Gustin is actually a very successful actor now. He plays the Flash. He's the Flash. The contestants would then perform the homework assignment in front of Robert and the guest judge, and the guest judge would select a winner, and the winner would receive a one-on-one slash little mentoring session with the guest judge. I'm not gonna lie, I do absolutely love these performances because they are done in a very enclosed space, and I can't lie, they aren't the best sometimes. Sometimes they're good, but sometimes they're like not that good. And you can tell that some of the guest judges are trying not to laugh. After the winner of the homework assignment is announced, Robert will then tell the contestants what the song is for the group performance slash music video, which is always, again, related to the theme of the week. And firstly, the group have to learn choreography from Glee choreographer Zach Woodley. And this is usually a painful uphill battle because a majority of the contestants are not dance trained. Then the contestants will record vocals with Nikki Anders, who, as I mentioned earlier, is a vocalist and songwriter on Glee. And then they will shoot the music video directed by Eric White. And then the music video will be played in full so we can all watch it. And I can't lie, Lem said this. The music videos remind us of, you know when someone pays for their child to have a music video made for them for their 13th birthday? It's kind of like that. Like, it's video style core. And the judges, Robert and Brad in the first season, and then Robert, Brad, and Nikki in the second season, announced the callback list. And everyone who is called back has made it through to the next episode. There isn't really an explicit winner ever announced or said, but it is implied that the first three or four people who are called back did the best in the music video slash excelled the most that week. And then the judges announce the bottom three. Not the bottom two, the bottom three. I got French tips on my nails because I wanted to go for something simple, and I thought I'd be like, oh my gosh, Parisian girl, Lily Rose Depp. But because my acrylics are so long, I think it just looks like Carmela Soprano nails, which isn't a bad thing. And the bottom three are assigned a song from the judges, which they have to perform in front of the judges and Ryan Murphy. Yes, as in the creator of Glee, Ryan Murphy. And this is also known as the last chance performance. And then there's a bit of back and forth. Sometimes there's a little bit of drama, but it's mostly sort of critique, positivity, compliments, you know. But overall, the contestants basically have to plead their case of why they shouldn't be eliminated. And at the end of every episode, which is probably my favorite part of the entire episode, Keep Holding On plays in the background as the bottom three walk slowly up to the callback sheet to see whether they've been called back or not. And when I first watched it, I assumed that the person who wasn't called back wouldn't be on the callback sheet. That's how callback sheets work. But instead, just to make it really clear to the contestants and the audience, in big block letters under the people that are called back is a big not called back with the person who's been eliminated underneath. Again, maybe I find this so funny because I watched one of the seasons nearly in an entire day. I spent 8 hours watching the Glee Project, and I think I was starting to go a little bit stir crazy. And then every episode finishes off with the entire cast, contestants, ensemble of contestants singing Keep Holding On with the person who's been eliminated singing like the solo part.
There's nothing you can do, there's no other way when it comes to truth.
So keep holding
on, 'cause you know we make it through.
And the contestant gazes into the camera and sings the final line of the song and then fades into the background. It's probably gonna sound really mean, but like, new ick unlocked. 'Cause you know I make it through, make it through. Let's finally introduce the contestants to you guys. Any of you guys that are familiar with my reality TV content, when I'm talking about contestants, I usually split it into contestants I like and contestants I don't like. But I'm gonna be honest, I couldn't really split the contestants because there weren't any contestants. I mean, there were a few, but there weren't that many contestants who I really, really liked or really, really disliked. And I think that one thing that the Glee Project didn't do particularly well, which isn't necessarily like a flaw in the show or anything, but the Glee Project didn't do the best job at showing off their contestants' personalities. The show was very much focused on the actual tasks themselves, you know, the homework assignment, shooting the music video, the choreography, recording in the studio, rather than the contestants and their personalities and their relationships with each other, which I understand the whole purpose of the show was to find the next star of Glee. And you do get an insight in what the contestants' personalities are like and some of the drama, but it wasn't the central focus. The central focus was the contestants' acting, singing, and dancing abilities. And that's completely understandable. As I said earlier, the whole purpose of the Glee Project was to find the next star of Glee. The prize for the Glee Project was a 7-episode arc on Glee. I just think we're so used to with reality TV show these days, with it focusing solely on the contestants' personalities and their relationships with each other, that maybe that's why I didn't enjoy the show much, because it's just not what I'm used to. And this is your warning. A lot of these contestants are theatre kids. They're all theatre kids. So firstly, we are going to start out with season one, which had 12 contestants. The first contestant we had was Bryce Ross Johnson, who was 22, which made him one of the oldest of the contestants. And his whole thing was that he was good looking. And that was kind of it. And then we had 18-year-old Ellis Wiley, whose whole thing, her entire personality trait, was that she looked younger for her age. I'm not going to lie, she seems like a nice person, but she did not shut up about how she looks 12. One thing I will say, again, they did her dirty, because in the first season, the like confessional clips were done in like this really unflattering, like close up angle. We have this clip of Ellis saying that she always gets mistaken for being 12 years old. She looks really, really young for her age. Then it cuts to her confessional camera, which is so up close to her that she looks like she's in her mid 20s.
Either way,
I promise I'm not 10.
I'm sick of being 10. I really am.
But I will give her credit where credit's due. When the cameras are zoomed out, she's very short, so she does actually look young for her age. But it was weird, because what Glee would do is Glee very much stressed that your differences make you unique and you need to embrace what makes you different. And Glee was such a popular show because all of the protagonists, a lot of them, were considered to be losers. And they were bullied by jocks and cheerleaders, and that's what a lot of young people can relate to. But some of the contestants would use this one unique trait that they have, for example, looking young for your age, and completely let that define them and build their entire character or performance around that one trait. So for example, in the first episode, Ellis literally dresses herself up as a child and carries a teddy bear around with her everywhere and acts like a child. And because of this, it actually lands her in the bottom three, because she let this one trait define her and put herself in a box, which is exactly what Ryan Murphy doesn't want. Next contestant is 22-year-old Emily. She's fun, she's flirty, she's very confident, she's very sure in herself. And let me tell you, I was shocked when she got eliminated in the third episode, the vulnerability episode. And I'm pretty sure it's because the judges felt like her fun and flirty personality was getting in the way of getting to know who the real Emily was. But even then, she got eliminated too soon. But this is your warning, you guys. This is not the first unjustified elimination in the Glee project. There's many more to come. The next contestant is 19-year-old McKinley. We don't see a lot of her in the show, and I don't know whether it's just because she didn't get a lot of screen time or whether because she's more of a shy and reserved contestant. And the next contestant is 19-year-old Mateus, who has dwarfism. And despite Glee's many flaws, one thing I'll give them credit for, I think that they handle disabilities well. Obviously, there are things to improve upon. Use of the R slur, the fact that the actor who plays Artie isn't actually in a wheelchair. You know, they could have just gotten a disabled actor to play Artie, but they don't infantilize their disabled characters, and their disabled characters like Artie and Becky, their character development doesn't stop at them having a disability. Mateus is just a quintessential heartthrob. He's quite cocky, and Ryan Murphy tells him to embrace his sexiness. And then we have 19-year-old Marissa, who again, I don't have a lot to say about because I just don't feel like she got a ton of screen time, but she did open up in episode 3 about how she has anorexia. And the next contestant is 21-year-old Cameron. Now, Cameron is pretty religious. He's a Christian, and he actually ended up quitting the show in the 7th episode because he felt like it was just going against his religious beliefs and it was just getting a bit too much for him. And I'm going to talk more about the repercussions of him leaving the show later in this video, but he was definitely the fan favorite, so much so that he actually won the Bing fan favorite competition in the final episode and won $10,000. And the next contestant is Hannah, who I don't have a lot to say about, but it has been a while since I've watched season 1, I'm not gonna lie. I did not write this script with fresh eyes or ears. So I'm going to read a quote from her page on the Glee Project fan wiki. In the show, she was known as MC Hannah, with her signature skadoosh and her comical personality. Self-conscious about her weight, she uses her keen sense of humor and exuberance to overcome any negative feelings about her appearance. Hannah also had a crush on fellow contestant Damien, and let me tell you, they did her dirty in that edit.
Damien, you can try to seduce me.
Damien is definitely someone that I could have feelings for.
On the show, it seems like a very much one-sided crush, like very one-sided. But she actually did an interview with, I think it was Entertainment Weekly, where she said that Damien actually reciprocated the feelings for her. It just wasn't aired on TV. Like, they just cut it out of the show. Oh my gosh, if that was me, I would sue. But what I mostly remember about Hannah is Skadooshgate, and I cannot believe I'm dedicating a part of this video to talk about Skadooshgate. Skadooshgate interval. So, Hannah used to say the word skadoosh, like skadoosh. Oh. And during the rapping week, which I think was like episode 2, Sam said skadoosh in his rap, like skadoosh. And then Hannah accused Sam of copying skadoosh from her.
Skadoosh.
You actually said skadoosh, and I was a little bit frustrated because apparently Nikki thought it was hilarious, and it wasn't his thing.
He didn't give me credit for it in the booth because Nikki apparently loved it, you know?
Like Lem said, is everyone just forgetting that skadoosh was a Jack Black catchphrase? Like, it's not Sam's, and it's not Hannah's. It's Jack Black's, as in the famous actor Jack Black, as in Kung Fu Panda Jack Black. Jack Black is not mentioned once though. Jack Black needs to send a cease and desist letter. Next contestant is Alex, who you probably recognize because they had a lot of success after the show, which I'm going to talk about later. But Alex is confident, very talented, very sure of themselves, really likable. But because they're so talented, some of the judges thought that they weren't really trying, which I don't really necessarily think is the case. Alex is gay, and on Glee, they portray a transgender character called Unique, but in real life, they identify as gender non-conforming and go by any pronouns. The next contestant is 19-year-old Lindsay, who is literally just Rachel Berry in real life, but a bit more mean.
Bring him closer, like maybe kiss him.
I've never actually been kissed, like legit.
It's awesome. Yeah, you better be jealous.
I'm not. Sorry.
First kiss? It's not a first kiss.
There's no other way to describe her, really. She is very confident. She talks a lot about how she's classically trained and how she believes that she's the one to be. And I'm not gonna lie, she definitely is. The next contestant, which is one of me and Lem's favorites, and that is Damien. He's from Northern Ireland, which is why he's one of me and Lem's favorites, because he's Irish, that's it. And he was a part of Celtic Thunder and had been touring with them since he was about 14 years old. Damien is likable, he's friendly, he's charming, he's very down to earth, and he's just a normal guy who likes singing smooth, jazzy songs. Damien is very much like Michael Bublé Christmas album vibes.
I know you think you had a weak day yesterday, but couldn't have done anymore, you know?
Now, he definitely wasn't the strongest competitor. He actually ended up in the bottom 3-4 times, but despite this, he still managed to make it through to the final. And the last season one contestant is Sam, who there just isn't much to say, to be honest. I'm gonna talk about it more later in the video. I don't think that he's like untalented or anything, but I do believe that he did coast on his looks for a lot of the competition. As I said, we'll talk about it later, but I think Lem's coming down now to give his thoughts about Sam.
I think that he's got a very weak, flat and uninteresting voice, especially compared to the rest of the contenders. And he also dances very weirdly.
Now for season 2 contestants, finally. Now, in season 2, there are 14 contestants rather than 12. The first contestant we have is 22-year-old Maxfield. And I don't know whether it's because I watched a majority of the Glee Project season 2 in one day that it's all just turned into one painful blur. But I literally do not remember this man. I don't remember him. Like, I actually don't remember. Guys, I'm not even trying to be dramatic or trying to be like, haha, oh my God, who's this? I'm being deadly serious. I have no idea who this guy is.
I hate to say it. I hope I don't sound ridiculous. I don't know who this man is. I mean, he could be walking down the street. I wouldn't know a thing. Sorry to this man.
And me and Lem were laughing because he does look quite old to be in the Glee Project. If anyone's watched Hell's Kitchen before, we all know how much I love Hell's Kitchen here. Sometimes Gordon Ramsay would dress up as a contestant, pretend to be a contestant for like the first half an hour of the show, and then like unmask and be like, oh my god, it's me, Gordon Ramsay. I was starting to theorize, like, maybe Maxfield was one of the judges dressed up in prosthetics, and then he peeled it all off and went, oh my god, it's me, Ryan Murphy, or something. Maxfield is Ryan Murphy in prosthetics and stilts because he was really tall. And then there is 22-year-old Taryn, who ended up quitting very early on in the competition. Then we had 23-year-old Danny, who was a very talented singer, but the judges believed that they didn't have a personality big enough for the show, especially amongst other contestants. Danny tended to fade into the background a bit. The next contestant was 21-year-old Tyler, who was the Glee Project's first ever transgender contestant. At the time of filming, they identified as male, and now they identify as non-binary. Tyler is another one of those contestants who I just think got eliminated too early. Even though they weren't the strongest competitor, I just don't think the judges gave Tyler enough of a chance. They were a very talented singer, and I would have rather the judges given Tyler a chance rather than someone like Michael, but we will talk more about Michael later. The next contestant is 24-year-old Mario, who hands down had my favorite voice of the entire season. He was such a talented singer. He's blind, so he had to work a lot harder than the other contestants to do things like choreography. Other contestants accused him of being argumentative and not listening when it came to things like assigning singing parts for the homework assignment, but also I think like it's a competition. Of course he's going to fight for the singing part which he thinks is best for him and is going to show his talent the most and make him stand out.
This is not RuPaul's best friend,
right? Sherlock.
And again, he's another contestant which I thought got eliminated way too early. Like, I don't understand how Mario got eliminated before Abraham. And then we have 22-year-old Charlie, who reminded me so much of Corey Monteith, the actor who played Finn in Glee. Like, they had very similar mannerisms. And Charlie was definitely a bit of a character. He was quite intense and he would do anything and everything to stand out. But unfortunately, his choices could be a bit misguided at times. One example is in a music video where Charlie is playing a bully and Mario is playing his victim. Without consulting anyone, Charlie took Mario's cane, which obviously I'm sure you guys can assume it's a big no-no. It's very dangerous. He immediately gets told off for this, which is completely understandable. Like, he shouldn't have done that. He completely crossed the line. One thing I found weird was they still used this footage of Charlie taking Mario's cane in the music video, which I just don't think they shouldn't have done. Because first of all, I can imagine it was a very horrible experience for Mario. But not only that, I don't think you can reprimand someone for taking someone's cane, which is understandable. You should reprimand people for that. But you shouldn't reprimand someone and then at the same time use that footage in the music video. Charlie did apologize to Mario and Mario accepted his apology. Charlie also had an on-screen romance with his fellow contestant Eileen, which he was very invested in. He got a little bit emotional over, which is understandable. I can imagine it's a very intense environment. And they actually dated for around a year after the show aired. The next contestant is 19-year-old Nelly, who was on the more shy and reserved side. But when she was pushed to do more out there and sexy scenes, she definitely rose to the challenge and actually excelled. But again, she's one of those contestants which I just don't have a lot to say about. And I think that is a problem with season two. I don't think it's the problem with the contestants themselves. I just think there were way too many contestants and they all didn't have their time to shine, especially the more shy contestants. The next contestant, and by the way, we've only surpassed the halfway mark with season two, is 24-year-old Abraham, who again, I don't have a ton to say. He would often talk about how he was raised by two mums and he was very insecure at coming across as feminine because he used to be bullied in school for being feminine. One moment which stands out to me specifically is he's in the bottom three. He sings Man in the Mirror by Michael Jackson and he doesn't do the best job. So then he storms the stage and says that he knows he can perform better than that, that he's sorry and that he's not leaving unless he wins the Glee Project. He's not leaving. And then Ryan Murphy says to him, oh, I thought you were coming on the stage to ask to perform again. And it completely goes over Abraham's head and Abraham just goes, okay, and walks off.
I'm not
freaking leaving until I either win this competition or you write a role for me on Glee.
I thought when you were walking back out here that you were going to ask to sing again.
All right, thank you guys.
Thank you.
And he ends up getting eliminated that episode. And then we have 22-year-old Shanna, who is very bubbly and energetic and sweet and, again, likeable. And she put her everything in this competition and very rarely slipped up, which is why I was completely shocked when she got eliminated 2 episodes before the finale, especially because it was her first time in the bottom three. But one Shanna moment which really stands out to me is Ryan Murphy is asking her basically like, what type of group do you represent? Like, what girls do you want to be watching at home? And they're going to look at you and they're going to say, oh my gosh, she's just like me. And Shanna says, sporty girls who can do everything but also sing their ass off. The next contestant is 18-year-old Michael, who, again, I literally don't have much to say to him. Again, he just didn't have much about him. The only thing I really remember about him is that he would always mention that him and Blake are best friends, and it felt very producer-forced, because what normal person constantly mentions that they're best friends with their best friend every, like, 10 minutes? But one thing I will say, he did grow a lot in the competition. He improved a lot, but he shouldn't have gone as far as he did. And the next contestant is 18-year-old Lily, who got off to a little bit of a rough start in the competition. She'd often talk back and be quite argumentative with the judges and the music video director. And one of the episodes where nearly all of the contestants were talking about how they've been, like, horribly bullied and, like, talking about the trauma from being bullied in school, Lily admits that she used to be a bully and that she watched Mean Girls and it changed her ways.
Middle school, I was the bully. I remember in 8th grade watching Mean Girls and being like, oh my God, that's me.
But despite all of this, she made it all the way to the penultimate episode. She was a very good singer, and she was another one of those contestants that would name drop that they were classically trained. And she had a little bit of a rivalry with fellow contestant Eileen. Speaking of Eileen, she's the next contestant we're going to be talking about. She is a 22-year-old Turkish Muslim, but she was a little bit of a wild child in on-screen romance with Charlie. She had rivalry with Lily. And I can't lie, with this rivalry with her and Lily, she could actually be a little bit mean.
Lily, back up a little bit because I can only hear you on the...
Sorry.
Look how red Lily is.
But overall, she was very determined, and that's why she got as far in the competition as she did. The next contestant is Ali, who is 24 years old, and she is actually paralyzed from the chest down, so she's a wheelchair user. And this means that she can't engage the diaphragm, stomach, or core as someone in her vocal range would normally do. She has had to create her own singing techniques to accommodate to her paralysis. And she did so well on the show. She very rarely complained. She worked extremely hard. She rarely had slip-ups. And she worked really hard throughout the competition, and she definitely had the talent to show for it. The last contestant is Blake. Now, you may recognize him because he had a lot of success after the show. Spoiler alert, he actually won. And you may recognize him because he dated one of his Glee co-stars, Melissa Benoist, in 2013. They got married in 2015 and divorced in 2019. In 2019, Melissa shared her experience with domestic abuse on Instagram. Benoist also stated that she had experienced extreme control, manipulation, and cycles of severe violence, including being slapped, punched, shoved into a wall, dragged by her hair, and choked during the relationship. And Blake had also thrown a phone at her face, which had torn her iris and left her pupil permanently enlarged. After this, Blake would then make an Instagram post admitting to the eye injury, but saying that the relationship was mutually abusive because she had also hit him. But Melissa responded saying that she only ever hit him in self-defense. Obviously, I believe her. Ryan Murphy, being the creator of Glee, and Glee having its more than fair share of cursed moments. Of course, the Glee project was about finding undiscovered talent, especially talented actors, singers, and dancers. But the show was also about finding someone who was a good fit for Glee, so someone who can overcome the challenges of show business. So they really put these poor contestants through it. The episode in season one where all of the contestants cover MC Hammer's Don't Touch This.
Told you, homeboy.
If the top of my skull could screw off like a bottle cap, I would get a scaler and scrub this memory from my brain. It was so bad. And I don't understand why I was so shocked that there was bad rapping in the Glee project, as if Mr. Shu and Artie haven't done enough damage already. Everyone's dressed in the most aggressively neon 2010s outfits. Marissa starts throwing ass out of nowhere.
Like, that is hot.
It was also the beginning of Skadooshgate, which I can't prove yet, but I am like 99% certain that it has knocked off about 5 years of my life. Speaking of bad rapping, in season two, all of the contestants performed Party Rock Anthem by LMFAO. This one definitely isn't as cursed as the MC Hammer cover, because LMFAO, Party Rock Anthem, isn't like a rap heavy song in my musical opinion. But again, it's just one of those things which is so 2010 that it like could be considered a historical relic. You could put it in a time capsule. Also, the music video was a disaster and everyone's dancing was really, really bad. It was actually really funny. It was cursed, but it was funny. Sometimes curses can be funny. But by far, by miles, by light years, the most cursed challenge is in season one's vulnerability episode. Oh my, you know what, guys? Where all of the contestants had to write their biggest insecurity on a sandwich board and then wear that sandwich board whilst they shot the music video in one of the busiest malls in LA. Why? The judges clearly wanted to push the contestants to their emotional limits because they would chastise contestants who weren't being vulnerable enough. And it was clear that the contestants felt pressured to put their biggest insecurity on the sandwich board, even if they didn't want anyone to know about it. It just felt so wrong. That's the only way I can describe it. It felt wrong. And some of these contestants' insecurities clearly came from very deep-rooted trauma, whilst other contestants, because remember, most of them are young adults or teenagers, didn't really have that many insecurities. So like Lindsay, who's very confident and sure in herself, her insecurity was that she's worried in case people think she's fake. So she had in a big sandwich board was written fake across it. Compared to Marissa, whose biggest insecurity is that she has anorexia, and I'm not trying to pit people's insecurities against each other or anything like that, but I think some of the stark differences made the music video feel a bit unbalanced. One challenge which really made me laugh in season two was from the adaptability episode, where the contestants didn't know the lyrics to the song they were singing until they got into the recording studio, because this can sometimes happen on the set of Glee. And I thought that they would have chosen like a song from an indie band or like a really old song, but they chose Price Tag by Jessie J.
Unite!
And barely any of them knew the song. Barely any of them knew the lyrics to Price Tag by Jessie J, or even knew what Price Tag by Jessie J was. Was Price Tag by Jessie J not a popular song in the States? But by far the worst challenge, as in like the worst to actually endure, like I wouldn't want to do this challenge, was from the season two Tenacity episode, where the contestants were assigned the song The Eye of the Tiger. Eye of the Tiger. Sorry, I just realized I have a microphone and I'm talking about the Glee project. This is my perfect time to showcase my voice. Took my chances. And the music video was exercise and gym themed. Fun, right? Wrong. The music video was to be shot in one take. The Glee Project were in their 1917 era. The Glee Project were in their Birdman era. And if anyone messed up, they would have to start the music video all the way from the top. They had to run up steps, throw balls, go through tires, jump hurdles, do double dutch on a skipping rope. They had to change out of their clothes and then form a pyramid, and then Ali had to throw a basketball backwards and it had to land in the hoop. The poor contestants had to shoot this music video over 50 times with barely any breaks, and one of the contestants, Shanna, even threw up. I got exhausted just watching this episode. I just couldn't. I'm sure you guys are dying to know how each season finale panned out. Let's start out with season one first. I know you guys are dying to know these season two unjustified eliminations, but we're starting out with season one. We're not getting too ahead of ourselves. In the season one finale, the final four are Lindsay, Alex, Damien, and Sam. Ryan Murphy gets all of the eliminated contestants back to help them with the final music video, which is Raise Your Glass by Pink. They all actually did really well. I thought the music video was really good and fun, and it sounded good. It was just good vibes. After shooting the music video, every single contestant gets a last chance performance, and they all sing a song which they have chosen themselves to the judges, Ryan Murphy, their fellow contestants, and all of the guest judges and the Glee cast. And in the end, Ryan Murphy announces that the winner of the Glee project is Sam. I was definitely disappointed about this. And you know what I was most disappointed about? Is I know why Sam won. Sam won because Cameron quit. As I mentioned earlier, Cameron was really religious and he quit for religious reasons, pretty much. And Ryan actually really liked the fact that Cameron was religious and wanted to write a religious character because he'd never done that before. He always had the ideas to write a religious girl, but it had to be really, really interesting to write a religious male character. And when Cameron quit, Ryan even expressed how disappointed he was because he thought that Cameron really was going to go all the way. So it was very clear to me that Ryan had this religious character and role written out for Cameron in his head, but then Cameron quit. And it seemed that Ryan was looking for someone to fill this role that he had already written in his head for Cameron. And Sam basically jumped at the opportunity, which I don't blame him for. He told Ryan about how religious he was and how he was perfect for a religious role. And I'm not saying that Sam is faking being religious by any means. I'm really not. But I do think that the only reason Sam won is because Cameron quit. Or at least I think one of the reasons why Sam won is because Cameron quit. I don't think he's like a bad singer or a bad actor. I just think he coasted on his looks for quite a lot of the competition. And I also think the other three finalists were better than him. After Sam is announced as the winner of the Glee project, Ryan Murphy then announces that Damien has also won the Glee project. So what? Both Sam and Damien would be receiving 7 episode arcs in Glee. And then after that, it's announced that Alex and Lindsay both won 2 episode arcs in Glee. So everyone won. It was honestly like such a wholesome finale because everyone won, like such Glee fashion. Everyone won. Everyone won. But in the second season, the judges and Ryan Murphy made it very clear that there could only be one winner. I can imagine that there were some execs. There were some studio execs who were furious with Ryan Murphy. The final three of season two are Eileen, Alex, and Blake. And again, they did the same as the season one where they brought back the eliminated contestants to help them with the music video. I can't remember the song they sung. It was set in a prom and it's a song that goes, I woke up with a strange tattoo. That was really good. And also Damien guest stars in the music video. I was starstruck. All three sing their last chance performance of songs they've chosen out. And let me tell you, Ali blew it out of the fucking water. She sung a song from Wicked. I don't know which song, and I'm not a huge musicals person, but like she did really fucking well and I really enjoyed it. It was so good. And they all performed in front of the judges, Ryan Murphy, their fellow contestants, and the guest judges, and also some of the Glee writers. And a majority of them agreed that Ali absolutely killed it. And even Diana Agron, who plays Quinn on Glee, said that Ali being in Glee is so important because the actor who plays Artie, Kevin McKay, doesn't use a wheelchair in real life. So after he shoots the scene, he can just get up, which not a lot of people who use wheelchairs can do. Blake wins. This shit is fucking rigged. I don't actually think that the Glee project is rigged, but I don't think that they pick a winner based on the most talented person or who has the best track record. They pick a winner based on who is the easiest to write for, or if they already have an idea for a role for them, which I don't necessarily think is always a terrible thing. But I think it begins to get under my skin when the Glee Project really prided itself on the diversity of their contestants. There were non-white contestants, there were LGBTQ+ contestants, there were contestants with disabilities. And these contestants were often asked, how do you think you'd make people like you feel if they saw you on Glee? Despite this, All three winners are straight cis men. Two of them are white, apart from Sam, who's half Mexican. I just don't think those three deserve to win. And I'm going to be honest, as much as I like Damien, he was in the bottom three four times. And Sam won because Cameron quit. And if I'm going to be honest, I think it should have been the other way around. I think Sam and Damien should have been the runners up, and Alex and Lindsay should have won. And Blake, yeah, he was talented, I guess. And he was probably the strongest actor on his season. But Ali was just so much better than him. I just think it's a load of bollocks, to be honest. I thought I'd finish off this video with talking about where the Glee Project contenders are now. Obviously, I'm not going to be talking about all of them because there are so many contenders. I'm mostly just going to be talking about the people that have had successful careers after the Glee Project. One of the winners from season one, Sam, would actually star longer than his 7-episode arc in Glee. He actually ended up starring in Glee for nearly 2 seasons, and I stalked his Instagram, and there is not a trace on his Instagram that he was on Glee. And I think it's because he had dreadlocks, which he probably got criticized for. So now he has no pictures from before he cut his dreadlocks off. He now releases music and was actually in the After movies. He played Zed.
Well, well, look at the cat dragged in.
And if you guys want a video about After, please let me know. I'm not sure if I'm ready to conquer the ACU yet, the After Cinematic Universe. Damien starred in Glee for his 7-episode arc, and then shortly after the show, rejoined Celtic Thunder and continues to release music. Alex did particularly well after the Glee Project. Their 2-episode arc turned into a 2-season run on Glee. 1 season as a recurring character, and the next season as a series regular, meaning that Alex actually was on Glee more than the actual winners. Alex would continue to act after Glee, starring in Empire and Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist. They were on Broadway and continues to release music. After Lindsay appeared in her 2-episode arc on Glee, she would appear in episodes of Drop Dead Diva, Grey's Anatomy, Recovery Road, and since 2020, plays Elphaba. I'm not a Wicked musical fan. I'm sorry. I'm not a Wicked stan. Elphaba in the Broadway production of Wicked. Similarly to Alex, Blake's 7-episode arc actually turned into a recurring role on the show. He was promoted to a series regular in season 5, and then after Glee would star in What/If, Everybody Wants Some, American Animals, and The Edge of 17. Since Melissa Benoist shared her experience of domestic abuse, it seems that his work has dried up. I know it sounds really pessimistic, but I don't want to speak too soon because we know how abusers get treated in show business, and that is well. But at the moment, he doesn't really seem to be getting any work at all. And Ali has really excelled since the Glee Project. She did guest star in an episode of Glee as Emma's, I think it was her niece. She has also starred in MTV's Faking It, 10 Days in the Valley, Lethal Weapon, Drunk History, and Instinct. And she made her Broadway debut in 2015 with Def West revival of Spring Awakening, and in 2019 won a Tony for her ward as Ado Annie in Oklahoma. So that is this video done. I hope that you guys enjoyed it. Again, it was just sort of like a review, I guess, of what I thought of the show. Final thoughts. It was a good show. It was very of its time. It was boring. I didn't really like it, but I also am glad that a lot of the people from the show have succeeded. But yes, that is this video done. I hope that you guys enjoyed it. If you did, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and I will see you soon for another video. Bye.
Thanks, Terry. Baby likes the soup.